It is Warframe's 7th anniversary, and thankfully, very thankfully, the developers, Digital Extremes, has gone back and updated a lot of old stuff that the players have been asking for a long time. And similarly, I decided to go back and put in a little bit of background work for my videos, and hopefully the quality of my videos will go up a little bit moving forward as I continue going back on this background stuff that needs to be worked on. I think it's just something that you need to do. Making new content is important, but you got to go back once in a while and polish things or improve old systems. And that's what they've done. The new deferred rendering system looks amazing. It's beautiful. You can see very reflective surfaces. The lighting looks really cool. I like it a lot. The new loading screens user interface is a nice touch. The loadout icons also look different, which is cool. I like it. The new explosion effects also look really good. The new animations for knockdown or knockback also look cool. Just overall, there's tons of really cool features, stuff that wasn't even included in the patch notes, but still are very welcome. So good job, DE. Thank you so much for doing this. And it also shows just how quick they're able to do this. Like, they weren't hyping this patch up for months like they were hyping Railjack. This is something that I really would like to see. So, hopefully they do this more often, not necessarily all year long, but, you know, clearly it doesn't take that long for them to go back and fix old systems if they just hunker down and get into it. And it's really nice to see that they did that. I'm guessing that on their end, they found it more enjoyable than they thought they would have actually digging into all these systems. So with the 7th year anniversary, they've given out some new attachments, some new armor attachments. They look really beautiful. They're very reflective and shiny and cool looking. We've also seen a return of the Dex Furious and the Sindana. The Dex Furious is a really good status focused secondary pistol or automatic pistols. It has a very high rate of fire. It's good for popping nullifier bubbles, and it's good for applying a lot of status effects very quickly. So if you haven't used it, definitely try it out. It's a worthwhile weapon to check out. I like that they didn't bring back the Dex Sabaris. This gives those of us that have been with the game for a while some sort of exclusive item that remains a certain degree of exclusivity. But then again, I'm just speaking at the beginning of March. Maybe as the month rolls on, they'll give the Dex Sabaris out. But, you know, I like it when there's some exclusive stuff that you can show. Be like, look what I have. I've been playing for a long time. Da-da-da-da. Okay, so with all that out of the way, and congratulating DE for all the good stuff that they've done, let's talk about some of the stuff that could use some improvements. So first and foremost, let's talk about shotguns and their status chance. They use this formula, this one-size-fits-all formula, and let me tell you, it doesn't fit on every shotgun. They need to go back on each shotgun and resolve the issue on a case-by-case basis. What they did was they multiplied every shotgun status chance by 3 and then divided it by the number of pellets that shotgun shoots out. So in the case of the Exorcist, this works perfectly. The Exorcist has 3 pellets, so they took the original status chance, multiplied it by 3, and then divided by the 3 pellets. So you ended up with the same status chance on the Exorcist after the patch as you had before the patch. But not every shotgun shoots 3 pellets. Take the comb, for example. The comb starts off by only shooting 1 pellet, and then as you hold the trigger down and it spools up, it begins shooting faster and it begins shooting more pellets, 2 pellets, 3 pellets, and so on. When they applied the formula to the comb, they multiplied its status chance by 3, and then they divided it by the number of pellets it shoots out, and at base, without being spooled up, it only shoots 1 pellet, so they divided it by 1. Essentially, tripling the comb status chance. So the comb got significantly buffed and is applying status effects way faster than it should. Then you've got other weapons like the Tigris Prime, where it's got 8 pellets, if I recall correctly, maybe more. You multiply its status chance by 3, divide it by 8, and you end up with lower status chance than you had before the patch. So the solution is simple. Go on a case-by-case basis for each weapon, multiply the status chance by the number of pellets that the weapon has, and then divide the status chance by the number of pellets that it has. And then you'll end up with the same status chance after the patch as you had before the patch. That's just the obvious solution. So hopefully they do that. Let's talk about status effects in general. In my last video, I compared viral, corrosive, and heat. And the results were pretty simple. Viral was more powerful than corrosive and heat. And corrosive and heat were pretty much on par with one another, which was nice to see. I think viral is a little bit overpowered. It needs a slight nerf. And I think that corrosive deserves a minor change. Currently, on the first corrosive proc, you get, I think, 24% or something around 25% armor strip. And then you get an extra 6% after that for each corrosive proc, all the way up to 80% in total. I think they should buff the initial status proc to a 53% armor strip, and then each additional proc after that gives you a 3% armor strip beyond that, up to a maximum of 10 stacks, which would be 80% armor strip. It would be the same maximum as it is right now, but it would make it so that the first proc is on par with a heat proc. A heat proc, right off the get-go, has 50% armor strip, and then each additional proc after that has a damage over time element that can stack with no limits. You can have 50 heat procs on an enemy at the same time, all dealing damage over time. So I think that for to consider slower firing weapons, they should buff up the initial armor strip on corrosive to 53% and then still keep the 80% cap. That just makes sense to me. Let's talk about impact, puncture, and slash. They remove the 4x multiplier for your chance to apply in impact, puncture, or slash proc. I don't really like this. It's harder to get an impact, puncture, or slash proc now unless you mod your weapon towards those damage types. And I'm okay with modding my weapon towards those damage types, but modding your weapon for impact, puncture, and slash is much less effective for your overall damage output than putting an elemental mod in. And the reason, if you're a veteran player or representative, you probably know, is that if you add, let's say, 90% impact damage to a weapon, it's only going to be 90% of the impact damage on the weapon that's added to it. If you add 90% heat damage to a weapon, it adds up the sum total of all of the different types of damage on the weapon and then adds 90% of that as heat damage to the weapon. So it's much easier to build a weapon for a specific elemental damage type than it is for a specific physical damage type. So what I think DE should do is go back to the mods that give you 120% slash or 120% impact or 120% puncture, and reduce them down to 90%, and then have them apply in the same way, using the same formula that elemental mods do. Instead of only improving or only taking 90% of the impact, puncture, and slash, just add up the total of all the damage on the weapon and add impact, puncture, and slash based on all of that. It would make things a lot more consistent across the board. You wouldn't have this special weird rule where the physical damage mods use a different formula than the elemental mods do, and it would give players a lot more control over the damage types of their weapons, and I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. I think it would be a fair way to resolve this issue. With that out of the way, I'm pretty happy with the changes. I'm happy with what they've done with arcanes. I'm happy with shield gating. The enemy accuracy algorithm seems to be working well, although I would like to see more details on how it actually works. On the forums, they brought up difficult versus easy content in Warframe. And that's a subject that I have a lot to talk about. But essentially, I really like what they've done with the disruption game mode in terms of difficulty. If you want to be efficient with your time, it's going to be more difficult. And I think that's really the best trade-off that they can have. Not necessarily that you get better rewards, but it's just that you can get rewards in a more efficient time frame at the cost of the content being more difficult. So if they can manage to use that as a balancing tool for future difficult content, where the content is easy if you want it to be, and it's hard if you want it to be, and the reward for it being hard isn't necessarily better rewards, just faster rewards, more time efficient rewards, I think that would be a good way to do it. Overall though, again, I'm very happy with what they've done. I think Digital Extremes doesn't get enough credit for the good things that they do. People are very, very focused on the mistakes and the errors and the problems, but you know, make sure to take a moment to congratulate them and say thanks for all the good stuff, and you know, be appreciative of all the good content that they put out. But that's it. That's all I've got to say. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next one.